Around 200 million men across the world have the Y-DNA haplogroup R1b. It is the most common Y-DNA lineage in Western Europe today, accounting for the paternal ancestry of over 110 million men. It is also very common in men of European ancestry who live across the world. In the US, for example, R1b is the most common Y-DNA haplogroup, as you can see in this table. And Steppe Ancestry is found in even more people globally. An estimated 700 to 800 million people have this ancestral component to some degree, with between 30 and 60% of autosomal DNA in modern Europeans coming from Steppe Ancestry. Yet this wasn't always the case. So in this video, we're going to look at the origins of R1b and the rise of Steppe Ancestry in general, and look at how this changed Europe forever. Now today, rates of R1b follow a strong west-east gradient in Europe. Frequencies reach over 80% in regions such as Ireland, Wales and the Basque Country. This declines as you move eastward across Europe, where the likes of R1a is more common. Today, the dominant sub-branch in Europe is R1b M269, especially its offshoots R1b U106, which is connected to Germanic ancestry, and R1b P312. Now, key branches of R1b P312 include R1b U152, which is notably found in northern Italy, Switzerland and France today, R1b DF27, common in Iberia, and R1b L21, connected to Atlantic Celtic ancestry, in places like Britain and Ireland. This spread of R1b reflects a significant Bronze Age expansion tied to steppe migrations, and it marked one of the most transformative population events in European history. Yet the Y-DNA haplogroup R1b was found in Europe long before the Bronze Age, something we're going to look at just in a second. And please let me know in the comments below if you belong to R1b and which branch you belong to. Now I should note, even though R1b is very common in Europe, Western Europe, it is also found in other parts of the world, notably in Africa, parts of Central and Western Africa. The subclade found in Africa is R1b VA8. Why is this though, you may be asking? Well, the leading theory is that this lineage likely represents a back migration from Eurasia into Africa, possibly during the Green Sahara period, when the Sahara was wetter and more habitable. Now, what is the deep history of R1b? Well, this haplogroup ultimately descends from haplogroup A, the oldest Y-DNA lineage in the world that originated in Africa over 200,000 years ago. Through successive branches, including BT, CT and F, this line eventually gave rise to haplogroup K, which emerged around 50,000 years ago and spread across Eurasia. From K came haplogroup P, the ancestor of both R and Q, which likely arose in Siberia or Central Asia. P later split into Q, found in Siberia and Native American populations today, as well as R, the direct ancestor of both R1a and R1b. Haplogroup R likely emerged over 25,000 years ago, and the oldest person that we know who had the Y-DNA haplogroup R lived around 24,000 years ago. He is known as Malta Boy, and he lived in South Central Siberia. He belonged to a basal forum of haplogroup R. This haplogroup then divided into R1 and R2 shortly after, with R1 further branching into R1a and R1b. While R1a spread primarily into Eastern Europe, Central Asia and India over time, R1b migrated westward. This was especially the case after the expansion of steppe peoples during the Bronze Age, something we will discuss shortly. But who was the earliest carrier of R1b in Europe? Well, it was actually a hunter-gatherer known as Villa Bruno Man, who was also one of the oldest people we know that had blue eyes in the world, as I noted in a previous video. He was a Mesolithic hunter-gatherer who lived around 14,000 years ago and was from the land we call Northern Italy today. A 2016 study on the genetics of Ice Age Europe was surprised to find his Y-DNA haplogroup was R1b1. This is a basal form of R1b, predating the later more dominant R1b M269 lineage, which is found in many Western Europeans today. This was a very surprising finding, since R1b was an extremely rare haplogroup among Western hunter-gatherers during this time, who mainly belonged to branches of I2. So Villa Bruno Man, as well as a few other ancient Europeans, did belong to R1b, but this was extremely rare before the steppe arrival. So let's turn our attention now to the people that truly changed the genetics of Europe forever. This began around 5,000 years ago, when there was massive waves of migrations from the Pontic-Caspian steppe are in parts of Ukraine and southern Russia today, just north of the Black Sea. Prior to this massive wave of migration from the Pontic-Caspian steppe, the Y-DNA haplogroups in Europe were mainly dominated by I2 and G2A, reflecting both hunter-gatherer and early European farmer ancestry. This all changed very quickly, however. Ancient DNA shows that most Yamnaya males belong to R1b M269, especially the subclade R1b Z2103. This migration introduced a new genetic component into Europe called Western Steppe Herder Ancestry, often simply referred to as Steppe Ancestry. The root of this Western Steppe Herder component was a mix of two ancestries, and this was the genetic basis of the Yamnaya people as well. It was a 50-50 split between Eastern hunter-gatherer ancestry and Caucasus hunter-gatherer ancestry. The mitochondrial DNA haplogroups of the Yamnaya were more mixed, but U5 and U4 were common, and this reflects the hunter-gatherer component to a large degree, as well as others though, such as H, T, J, and K. Now, this steppe ancestry spread across Europe in numerous waves beginning around 3000 BC, and it also spread through numerous cultures that were connected to the Yamnaya, most notably the corded bear culture, more in Eastern Europe, and also the bellbeaker culture, more to the west, and especially the latter was instrumental in spreading the R1b lineage as well. Now, I should note that the bellbeaker and corded bear people did carry steppe ancestry, but also mixed with the earlier peoples of Europe as well. In other words, the picture is more complex than steppe peoples completely wiping out the previous peoples of Europe, as there was mixing as well as intermarriage. Corded bear males also tended to carry the lineage R1a much more, and also had an impact more in Eastern Europe, a legacy that's still felt today in the rates of the R1a haplogroup, as this map shows. The bellbeaker males, on the other hand, mainly carried the R1b lineage, notably the R1b P312 branch, and the later subclade R1b L21. In Britain, the bellbeaker expansion around 4,000 years ago resulted in a near total replacement of the local male line gene pool. A 2018 study in Nature found that the bellbeaker people brought high levels of steppe-related ancestry into ancient Britain. And this event is associated with the replacement of approximately 90% of Britain's gene pool within a few hundred years. This pattern is seen across Western and Central Europe in general, and represents one of the most rapid and widespread male lineage turnovers in history. It also forms the basis of the Y-DNA map of Europe today, as you can see in this map of the R1b levels in modern Europeans. Now, given how profound the impact of the Yamnaya was in related peoples, these peoples have got to be some of the most important, yet least well known in human history. So who were the Yamnaya? What did they look like? What was their diet like? And where did they come from? And how violent was their introduction into Europe? Is it more accurate to call it an invasion or a migration? And some have even went so far as to basically call it a genocide. But is this true? Now, the Yamnaya people grew up on the Pontic-Caspian steppe and in modern-day Ukraine and southern Russia, with this culture dated to between 3300 and 2600 BC. They are known for Kurgan mound burials and Okri graves, with the name Yamnaya literally meaning related to pits. They are also known for their early use of wheeled wagons and domesticated horses, although they weren't the first people to use either. Now, the Yamnaya likely spoke an early Proto-Indo-European language, and their westward expansion is believed to have spread both Indo-European lineages and R1b lineages into Europe. Their mobility and technological advantages helped them rapidly establish dominance over vast areas. They were also aided by their environment. The vast grasslands of the Eurasian steppe have been described as a landscape of movement, perfect for horses and wagons. Now, this is a reconstruction of what a Yamnaya man would have looked like. The average male was likely tall, lean and muscular. They were fueled by a high protein diet, both meat and dairy heavy, and this was supplemented with some grains and wild plants. Most men also had dark hair, brown eyes and medium toned skin. And we do know for sure that they consumed dairy. An interesting 2021 paper in Nature was titled "Dairying Enabled Early Bronze Age Yamnaya Steppe Expansions." Even though the Yamnaya did consume dairy though, and their migrations helped spread lactose tolerance across Europe, the Yamnaya themselves were not inherently lactose tolerant as a population. The gene for lactose tolerance, which allows adults to digest milk, was present in the Yamnaya population, but this was at relatively low frequencies. It was their descendants who, through natural selection and cultural practices, saw a significant increase in lactose tolerance. Yet the Yamnaya and their descendants are still a key reason why Europeans have high levels of lactose tolerance, compared to most other peoples around the world. And if you look at the side-by-side comparison between these two maps, R1b on one side and lactose tolerance on the other, you can see that there's a relatively strong correlation between the two. The rise of lactase persistence correlates with the arrival of steppe ancestry, and the spread of cultures like the Corded Ware and Belbeker peoples. And modern populations with higher steppe ancestry, such as Scandinavians, people in Britain and Ireland, and the Dutch, tend to have very high rates of lactose tolerance today as well. But how violent was the Yamnaya introduction? Was it more an invasion or a migration? Well, the argument that was quite a violent episode is strengthened by the fact that we know it was a male-biased migration or invasion. It was a male-biased episode. A 2017 study in Pinas, for example, found that for migrations from the Pontic-Caspian steppe during the late Neolithic and into the Bronze Age, we estimate a dramatic male bias, with approximately 5 to 14 migrating males for every migrating female. So we know that there was far more Yamnaya males than females that entered Europe during this time, and violence was bound to be part of this episode. Yet we know that there was other factors involved as well. The Yamnaya, for instance, had much better technology than the previous peoples of Europe. At least some of the Yamnaya rode newly domesticated horses, for instance, and they made use of wheeled wagons drawn by oxen, which helped them cover large distances. There may have been an element of sexual attractiveness as well in there, given these tall, quite muscular people on horseback with this new technology and also who practice dairy, and that might have explained some of the turnover, the male bias turnover in populations. As we know that the Y-DNA haplogroups dramatically changed during this time, but the mitochondrial haplogroups, the maternal haplogroups, were relatively stable or more stable in general. So the Yamnaya and steppe ancestry completely changed Europe forever, and by extension, the world. Given how many people of European descent live in places like the United States, Canada, Australia, New Zealand and South Africa, as well as various other places around the world, it's quite incredible the journey haplogroup R1b and steppe ancestry in general has been on. Related branches of the DNA marker of Yamnaya males is still carried by over 200 million men across the world, 5,000 years later. And steppe ancestry is found in even more people. Yet R1b is not only a genetic marker, but also a proxy for linguistic and cultural change, marking the demographic foundations of many modern European societies. Pretty much all European lineages are from the Indo-European lineage family, yet there are a few exceptions, such as the Basque lineage. Yet why is the Basque country such an enigma? On one hand, they have some of the highest levels of R1b in the world, yet on the other, they do not speak an Indo-European lineage. Well, to find out, please click here. Thanks for watching, please subscribe and hit the bell, and let me know your thoughts in the comments below, and if you belong to R1b, and which branch or subclad or SNP. But yeah, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next time.